So really, I don't think reenacting should ever be a substitute for the hard work of archival research. But I do think in small doses, participatory history can be a useful complement to more traditional research and a way to enliven history on the page. I think there's even more value in going to the places where history happened, where I've done in three of my books, essentially, footsteps journeys. Like reenacting, this can be a tricky exercise. Often the landscape is too changed, or the primary source is too sketchy to be sure you're even in the right place. And even if you are, it's hard to catch echoes of the distant past with traffic passing or planes overhead. Also, as any of you who have done this sort of travel know, monuments and local knowledge are riddled with myths and misconceptions. For my last book, A Voyage Long and Strange, I retraced the routes of the first Europeans to visit North America, including the Vikings. And to judge from all the runes you see and other relics attributed to them, the Vikings got absolutely everywhere, even landlocked Oklahoma, which never made much sense to me. Nonetheless, as a footloose writer without academic obligations, I felt fortunate to be able to do what few professional scholars can. I loitered at Newfoundland's remote and inhospitable northern tip, where the Norse briefly settled a millennium ago, and where the remains of sawed longhouses helped me grasp the harshness of life for North America's first European settlers. I also went to a ruined pueblo near Zuni, New Mexico, where archaeologists have uncovered 16th century Spanish musket balls and horseshoes, evidence of the shock and awe assault by conquistadors on natives who had never seen guns or armored men on horses. These kinds of trips helped me to better understand what happened and also to write more vividly about it than I could have done from library research alone. More broadly, I think research of this kind puts me in the right frame of mind to think about the history I'm recounting. As a contemporary writer in the era of jet travel and Google Earth, I can't possibly recapture the freshness of first contact or the sensation of sailing into the complete unknown. But traveling in the footsteps of early explorers, I felt a little closer to the vertigo and wonder of discovery, to the feeling of being blown off course like the Vikings, of having to improvise in a strange and hostile land like the Spanish castaway, Cabeza de Vaca, or the experience of seeing something entirely alien, like the naturalist aboard Cook's ship who was so baffled by a kangaroo that he described it as an 80-pound mouse. I think this sort of archive of the feet, as I'll call it, is particularly important today when so many young people are glued to their electronic devices. Although I've seen refreshingly few of them today, maybe the history crowd less so. When I speak to students, even ones at top universities studying history at the graduate level, I'm struck by how much they rely on their computers for their research. It's become very easy to convince yourself that you really don't need to go anywhere because you can see a picture of it online and find out pretty much whatever you need to know with a Google or JSTOR or other search. Well, that's simply not the case. You always learn more by going to the place. And that applies to research of documents as well. I'm a huge fan of small museums and local libraries and somewhat out-of-the-way repositories that I think are often neglected as sources of primary material. And I'll give you one example of that from my John Brown research. I went to the basement museum of the local historical society in Charlestown, Virginia, where Brown was imprisoned and hanged. And they have a sort of small exhibit of relics from 1859. And I chatted with the woman who runs the place. And I just asked, do you have anything that's not on display? And she smiled and got a key and opened the door to a storeroom filled with boxes and boxes of material that, as far as I could tell, no one had ever looked at. Diaries, letters, other treasures. And needless to say, she was delighted to have me camp out there for 3 days and also gave me the key to the copy machine. I found, some really good stuff. And through her, I also met local historians who had their own material and took me to private property, sites on private property that I otherwise couldn't have visited. I know some of you in the audience work in places like this, and my hat is off to you. I just wish more people got out from behind the computer and away from the high-profile sites and paid you a visit. I'm just going to close by talking a little bit about the writing process, which I think is also different for a journalist semi-pro historian. Scholars typically select a topic that allows them to build on their specialized knowledge of a particular subject, and they often begin by framing their work in relation to other scholars. Peer review, tenure, and other academic pressures all demand this of them. I'm fortunate to be free of those constraints, and as a former newspaper reporter, my instincts are different. I'm conditioned to write for the broadest possible audience. This means writing in a concise, jargon-free manner, and assuming that my readers are intelligent, but not necessarily well-informed about the subject I'm writing on. I also try and approach my subject without a theory, thesis, or preconceptions. As a newspaper journalist, you're also perpetually haunted by the image of your audience on the subway or during a coffee break, reading the first few paragraphs of your story and not being intrigued enough to follow it to the jump, which was the old phrase for the continuation of a story inside the paper. I don't know what you call a jump now on Kindles. You're competing with the sports page, all these other things, and you become obsessed with crafting an engaging start to your story, the lead, as it's known, and you try and develop a hook that will keep the reader on the line until they reach the kicker, which is newspaper jargon for the punchy ending you try to give to the story. Obviously, the formula for a newspaper piece of 1,000 words isn't directly applicable to a book, which is a marathon rather than a sprint. But I find I still think like a newspaper man when I sit at the computer. What's the headline? What's the lead? What's the hook? If you don't have those elements, you're in trouble, whether it's a newspaper story or a 400-page book. Newspapers also have a very strong sense of themselves as public servants, as news providers. The customer comes first. It's the general reader who must always be served. And in this sense, writing is a social act, or as Kurt Vonnegut put it, how to be a friend to the reader so the reader won't stop reading, how to be a good date on a blind date with a total stranger. One way I've tried to do this in my books is by keeping things a bit light and lively, particularly near the start, just as I'd do on a blind date. In Blue Latitudes, for instance, I felt the reader needed a fair bit of nautical information to understand Cook's voyages, but I didn't want this to be heavy sailing, so I wrapped it around my bumbling experience as a sailor on the Endeavor. This and my other books ultimately turned much more sober and I hope more substantive, but my thinking was, give the reader a little dessert first and make them eat their peas later. Lure them in with some larkish adventure and let the darker story gradually reveal itself, as it did for me. I think journalism also accustoms you to discipline in your writing. It's really an exercise in time and space management. And again, I think newspaper lingo is revealing in this respect. The daily log of stories is the budget, which we instinctively associate with cutting, particularly now. A news copy is measured not in words, but in inches, and the copy usually needs to be boiled down to fit the news hole. And then, of course, there's your deadline, not to mention the morgue, or stories that are buried inside the paper, or aren't even there because they've been spiked. Editors really love cutting and killing stories. I resented all this when I worked at newspapers, always fighting for a few more inches of copy. But I appreciate that training now that I'm writing about history, which I think more than any other topic really leads to books that are the size of the Oxford English Dictionary. And, you know, there's no real mystery to why that is. We all amass this tremendous amount of research and we don't want to let go of any of it. The best research, like the best travel, you know, requires an open and generous spirit. You have to be up for anyone and anything and any information you come across. But writing really requires the opposite. You have to be utterly ruthless. If some part of your material doesn't move the narrative along, it's got to go, no matter how many mountains you've climbed to get it, no matter how many officials you bribed, no matter how much torment and dysentery you endured. Now, it has to be said that I often ignore this advice. We all do. Because we all fall in love with our own material, and it's hard to kill the thing you love. Also, there's no manual for writing a book. Even E.B. White, whose co-authorship with Strunk of the book about proper usage of the English language, acknowledged it. As he put it, I write by ear, always with difficulty, and seldom with any exact notion of what is taking place under the hood. I'm just going to close by being my own editor for a moment and acknowledging some of the potential problems with writing history as a semi-pro. First, I'm haunted by the possibility that I'm oversimplifying the history or failing to provide proper context. No matter how hard I try, I can't match the depth of scholarship that comes from years of reading and teaching on a particular subject. Another issue is that journalism tends to make you allergic to abstraction and theory. You're accustomed to dealing with the concrete and giving examples rather than spinning big ideas. The axiom you always hear in newsrooms is show, don't tell. In theory, the idea is to let readers draw their own conclusions, but there's the danger, I think, of being too aloof and leaving the reader adrift. For me, the hardest part of any book is always stepping back in the prologue and epilogue and trying to explain what it all means and why it matters. Lastly, there's the gnawing guilt that comes from feeding off the work of others. I do primary research and interview historians and archaeologists, but often I'm unearthing scholarly work from the bowels of a library and distilling its content for readers outside the academy. I'll acknowledge this in my source notes and bibliography, but there's no escaping that I'm often a freeloader. As historian Samuel Eliot Morrison put it, academic scholars are heaping up the pay dirt for others, journalists, novelists, and freelance writers. But here's how I console myself or let myself off the hook when I feel qualms about living off the pay dirt heaped up by others. After I wrote Blue Latitudes, I started receiving fan mail from the family of J.C. Beaglehole, the premier scholar of all things related to Captain Cook. Previously little known outside his native New Zealand and obsessive Cook circles, Beaglehole was suddenly getting belated attention. And according to Amazon, readers of Blue Latitudes were most likely to make as their next purchase Beaglehole's long-ago biography of Cook. So I hope that people who read my books will be intrigued enough to go back and consult the sources I did. I also get a lot of letters from people who say, in effect, I hate history, I was always bored to tears by the Civil War, but I got Confederates in the Attic as a Christmas gift, and now I'm taking my family to Gettysburg. Any history books you can recommend? So contrary to the Sean Willens quote that I began with, I like to think that the semi-pros like myself and the real pros like some of you in the audience are in this together. So thanks for listening. And I've tried to...